It's a great joy and honor to speak at this Congress in the midst of all these great experts in Ayurveda from Ayush and around the world. My talk will be in some parts a little bit abstract, but I think this is the basis of concrete applications. My talk will be on the topic Ayurveda, the basis of integrative medicine. And I want to show that Ayurveda is not only the basis of integrative medicine, but of integrative life, because Ayu means life, science of lifespan and life. And the third International Ayurveda Congress in Rio in 2018, which we had organized together with the Brazilian Health Ministry, the task was to bring about 20 different alternative medicines into the healthcare system. Now the question is there a common basis of all these different systems? And so I will speak about scientific concepts which actually support this idea that which explains also these different systems. Dr. Picher has already mentioned a few of them. Actually, on this slide, I discover one is missing, important one, the microbiome, because this is also an important aspect. I will focus here now, I will pick out the systems approach, and in particularly the network medicine. This is an article in the New England Journal of Medicine, where modern science tries to integrate these different levels from the metabolic genetic network, then the disease network, and then the social network. But from an, this is, I think, is a great advantage and a great progress, but from an IV, we immediately think there is something missing, because we need also to take into consideration the environment, the near environment, the architecture of the house, the city planning, the nature, the ecosystem of the system. And on the other side, also on the bottom level, on the level of the atoms, the quantum mechanical level has also been considered. And according to Maharishi Ayurveda, we can even go one step further. And what would that be? That is what is smaller than the smallest, Mahado Mahayan, what is larger than the largest. Now we have a complete picture of all the areas which we have to cover when we want to achieve perfect health. And now I want to show the work from Professor Tony Nader, an MIT and Harvard-trained researcher who has, under the guidance of Maharishi Mahayogi, shown that the human physiology is actually the expression of Veda and the Vedic literature. Maharishi has put together the scattered Vedic literature into a science, and he has cognized that the structure of the Veda is actually its own commentary. This is the Aparashaya Bhashya. And on that basis, Dr. Nader has been shown that, for example, here, the Rig Veda, the 192 suktas of the first mandal of Rig Veda, the first book of Rig Veda, correspond to the 192 structures of the central and peripheral nervous system. And then, when we speak about integration, he went to all the different Vedic disciplines. I want here to show an example of yoga, because yoga means union, is the perfect example of integration. He is showing that the four chapters of the Yoga Sutras of Patanjali correspond to the four lobes of the brain. Not only that, but even the sutras of the different chapters can be matched on the folds of the cortex. Another area which is important to integrate is the human physiology, or the human being, and its environment, the cosmos. And this is shown on the next chart, where we see that the deep-seated nerve centers in the brain, the basal ganglia, correspond to the nine grahas, so-called nine planets in Jyotish, not only in their number, but also in structure and function. All this can be read in detail in his book, Human Physiology, Expression of Veda and the Vedic Literature. So these are the cosmic counterparts. And of course, from Veda we know all these sayings, yata pinde, tata brahmande, as is the individual, so is the cosmos, or as below, so above. And in Ayurveda, we have the famous law, loka purusha samya, which explains this connection and which is the basis of all our therapies. So in a few practical applications of this discovery are the Maharshi Vedic vibration technology, the Vedic sound therapy, and the model of Vedic physiology. Here we see this model where a 3D and this is a 2D model. When it is played, then the different parts of the body blink and the corresponding frequencies one can hear the Vedic sounds, so there's this connection. And this has a very great influence also just by looking at it and has a balancing effect on the physiology. And then there's the Maharshi Vedic Sound Therapy. It's an online streaming service of Vedic sounds where one can have a personalized selection of the body part which one wants to balance and hear the corresponding Vedic sounds. So in summary, it means that the structures and qualities of our consciousness, self-referent consciousness of Atma, are expressed in the sounds of the Veda. This is a completely new and astonishing discovery that these Vedic sounds are actually as the result of the self-interacting nature of our own consciousness. And these sounds are then in turn expressed in the structures and functions of the body, and then further expressed in the universe, in the environment. So we have Atma, Veda, Sharira, Vishva. And if all this is lively in our own consciousness, then we speak from of totality of Brahman. Now, what is the final frontier of science? I was surprised, but recently I saw a few articles and several papers and scientists says the final frontier of science is consciousness. A few decades ago, if you would have a scientist say you are researching in consciousness, you would have lost your reputation. But now it's becoming more and more. For example, here, understanding consciousness may be the greatest challenge posed on science, and it will help humanity push science to new unrealized limits. Now it's high time to say, what is consciousness? It's very familiar to us, but on the other hand, difficult to describe. You can leave the slides on, please. And then it is different philosophers and neuroscientists, mathematicians, computer experts have different definitions. But I think the most precise and comprehensive definition of what consciousness is comes from Maharshi. And he says, consciousness is that which is conscious of itself. It's a shockingly short definition, and it is self-referral. It's a little bit unusual, but immediately one sees there are three elements: consciousness, then being conscious, and of itself. And they are actually all the same. So one could say there's the knower, the knowing, process of knowing, and the known. And Maharshi calls this the three-in-one paradox, because it's one, but at the same time it is three. The three-in-one structure of consciousness. Now, to make it a little bit more concrete, in any experience, sensory experience, emotions, thinking, these three elements have to come together in order that we can have an experience. The subject, the object, and the process of which connects that. This is the integration. It's necessary. Here. Any sensory experience, any internal experience, always these three have to come together. And we say that the structures of consciousness are expressed in the Vedic sounds and then expressed in the physiology. So what is the expression of this three-in-one structure of consciousness in the physiology? This is the three-in-one structure as we see here. The information units, as Dr. Nader has shown in his book, the processing units, and the structuring units. And I think until now, everyone in the room will know, yes, this obviously relates to Vata, Pitta, and Kapha. Or one could also say the input, throughput, turnover, or output storage, Kapha. So this is just one example how this connection, everything has its origin in consciousness. And it means that the three doshas have actually their origin in consciousness. We have the oneness, the togetherness, samitā level, and then Rishi Devata Chandas, and then the physiology, this corresponds, this relationship expresses itself in the physiology as Vata, Pitta, and Kapha, hold together the integrative factor of ojas. And Maharshi has shown that actually all Ayurvedic terms can be traced back to consciousness, to our own consciousness. And this makes studying Ayurveda and practicing Ayurveda very intimate and very interesting. And if you want to know more about consciousness, I highly suggest to read Dr. Nader's book, One Unbounded Ocean of Consciousness, where he goes in very detail from Vedic science and modern sciences what has to be said and should be known about consciousness. It's really a new paradigm that unifies and integrates mind, body, and environment. And we are very fortunate in the afternoon, Dr. Nader will also address the Congress. Now from a slightly different angle, we have here the unified field chart of physiology, how physics thinks that the universe is structured. From the basis unified field of all the laws of nature or the theory of everything, and then we have the different force fields and matter fields, then comes the DNA, then the proteins, the macromolecules, the cells, and then the tissues, and then the organs, the organ systems, and then we have the individual physiology, then we have the society is also a kind of physiology, then we have the ecosystem of the Earth, and then the solar system. So this is the hierarchical structure. Now when we speak about that, where is the place of mind, of consciousness? Obviously, these are not two different and separate things, but common basis. And this is the unified field of all the laws of nature, or in Ayurvedic terms, Atma, or the state of self-referral consciousness. And this is the basis on which we build all our medical systems. And Dr. Bichler has already mentioned that, for example, scientists, physicists, Dr. Hägglin has spoken about the relationship about a unified quantum field, the three doshas and the Mahabhutas. We don't need to go in all the details, but it's very interesting that already in the 1980s, Maharshi invited, to my surprise, physicists and chemists and mathematicians to Ayurveda congresses, because he wanted to go deep in what is really the basis of Ayurveda and modern science, and it seems physics is able to create a bridge. This was made in 1985, Maharshi. I was reminded when I heard today Minister of Ayush speaking, and also when you were speaking about the global implementation of Ayurveda. Already in 1985, Maharshi laid out the plans, which includes all these different areas, training and products and practice. And he said actually at that time that it needed a scientific aid to discover the true value of Ayurveda. And we see this more and more, that science supports more and more the different concepts of Ayurveda. I'm going backward, okay. Now I should go forward, yeah. Yeah, so here, again now, these different levels. On the bottom we have pure being or Atma, self, then mind, body, behavior, society, and the whole environment. And this is the total range of natural law. And when, if we move health, then we have to cover all these areas and the corresponding levels of health. And here are a few examples of preventive and therapeutic modalities which we use in Maharshi Ayurveda, covering this total range of natural law. This in the self, swasthya. to be established in our own self-referent consciousness. So all these different therapies and approaches have to touch this area in order to make our therapy effective and long-lasting. Again, if we want to arrange it in that way, from Veda, also Atma, Veda, Sharia, and Vishwa, and also all the three great areas of therapies which are mentioned in Charak, Daiva Vyaprashaya and Yukti Vyaprashaya and Sattva Vichaya, are covered with these different approaches. But important is that every time it has to be enlivened, this inner intelligence of the body, the state of least excitation of consciousness. So Maharshi Ayurveda, and you see here we write Ayurveda a little bit unusual, the V is a capital V, because we want to highlight the importance of knowledge. Because otherwise, because there's no difference between Maharshi Ayurveda. Ayurveda is Nitya and Aparusheya, it's all the same. So, but if we want to make a difference, we say we highlight the importance of consciousness. And the aim is to restore the connection between the body and its source in consciousness, and thereby removing the mistake of the intellect, pragyaparat, and enliven the inner intelligence of the physiology. Perfect health in that sense means, therefore, perfect integration of all these areas. So integration is only possible, or finally possible, only on the level of consciousness, on the level of the least excitation of consciousness, when we are establishing the self, swastika. So I wanted to show with my talk that the basis of integrative medicine, Ayurveda, is actually more. It's not only medicine, it's life. And it has to cover all the areas in our life. For example, we have to integrate also the situation at the moment with the ex. It has to be integrated. And health means perfect integration. And also, interestingly, in Charak Samhita, when we have this whole chapter about epidemics, and the final conclusion is, what is the reason is, mistake of the intellect, brachyaparat. So again, we are with consciousness. So I think it's important, if we want to make Ayurveda mainstream, we have to put it on a strong foundation. And this is this knowledge of consciousness, the self-referral bit of our own consciousness, and that we can build a healthcare system which is free of side effects and prevention oriented. And actually, when we see here the word Ayush, then actually you are practicing integrating Ayurveda, yoga, unani, siddha, and homeopathy, and now just also modern medicine. So it's a great pleasure for me and joy for me to speak to this conference and to mention the basis of integrative life, of integrative medicine, is finally our own consciousness. Welcome, Jay Gurudev.